NHM 9 improved, it is tryptophan 0.68%, lysine 2.97%. Then at the international level in the crop sweet potato, provitamin A was targeted again. And you can see the orange sweet potato, which is rich in provitamin A. You can see the difference in the flesh color. The normal flesh of the sweet potato is yellowish in color, whereas if it is rich in provitamin A, you can see orange to dark orange color. That indicates the richness in provitamin A content. And you can see the kind of bread prepared from this sweet potato. In India, sweet potato Bhu Krishna was developed by CTCRN, where the anthocyanin pigment is about 90 mg per 100 grams. And then potato developed by CTCRA again, here the beta-carotene content is 14 mg per 100 grams. In cassava, then targeted nutrients were provitamin E and iron content. Targeted countries, these are the different countries which work on these crops for these micronutrients. And for beans, targeted nutrient was iron, and it was worked out in African countries. And different crops for different micronutrients, lentil, iron, zinc, potato, banana, provitamin A, coffee, iron and zinc. Different countries started working on different micronutrients depending on the crop they consume majorly. And in India, not only developing micronutrient-rich content varieties, but also reducing anti-nutritional factors. That is also a kind of biofortification. In case of mustard, varieties like Pusa 00 mustard, 31, varieties like, means they have developed a variety which is having less than 2% of erucic acid and less than 30 ppm glucosinolates. And in Pusa mustard 30, the erucic acid is again less than 2%. In lentil, Pusa Agathi Masoor, here the iron content is 65 ppm. And in vegetables like cauliflower, Pusa beta Kesari 1, beta carotene content is 8 to 10 ppm. And in fruits like pomegranate, Sholapur Lal, here iron content is 5.6 to 6.1 milligrams per 100 grams. Zinc is 0.64 to 0.69 mg per 100 grams. Vitamin C is 19.4 to 19.9 mg per 100 grams. Such is the extent of variability in the micronutrient content and richness of these nutrients in the pomegranate here. So this is one of the slides which I took from Harvest Plus site. This shows that the different biofortified crops bred all over the country, all over the world, are able to address and meet daily requirement of these micronutrients. For example, iron 12 millet, it is able to provide up to 80% of the daily iron needs. And the benefits are they are high yielding and this is resistance and drought tolerant. Similarly, for different crops, different characters were mentioned along with the extent of the nutritional benefit they are going to provide. Now, since my talk is on the related to benchmark level, now I'm going to talk about these different benchmarks and in different crop and then come down to 12 millet. I have shown you some varieties which have been released, developed and released by different institutes in the country and also in the world. Now, this is one slide which I'm going to speak about the status of the baselines and levels achieved in different crops in India. For rice, for zinc, the baseline it was about 12 to 16 ppm and the levels achieved were 20 ppm. For protein, 78%, more than 10% was achieved. For wheat, the level fixed was 28 to 32 ppm for iron, but the level achieved is more than 38 ppm. For zinc is 30 to 32 ppm, achievement is more than 40. For maize, lysine targeted is 1.5 to 2, the achievement is more than 2.5%. For pearl millet 30 to 35, more than 40 ppm for zinc and more than 70 ppm for iron. Similarly, for vegetable crops like cauliflower, beta carotene, it was very negligible. They could come up to 8 ppm, more than 8 ppm. Sweet potato, I just now showed, anthocyanin content, they have achieved to more than 80 mg per 100 grams of the pulp. A pomegranate, vitamin C, this much iron and zinc. And I also said that reduction in the anti-nutritional factors is also a kind of thing which they are looking for. In mustard, they could obtain glucosinolates reducing from 120 ppm to less than 30 ppm, and erucic acid reducing from 40% to less than 2%. And in soybean, punnet inhibitor reducing from 30 to 45 mg to almost negligible. So this is all about the kind of different kinds of biofortification taken up in different crops. Now I'm coming to the topic of millets or pearl millet. Before I go directly into pearl millet, many people confuse millets. They think that sorghum, pearl millet, millets are either combinedly they call sorghum, pearl millet, small millets, everything as millet. But there are different kinds of millets. Millets is a common term used for representing this group of grains. Millets are one of the earliest grains that are being cultivated and consumed by the people in India and world. We have different kinds of millets, major millets and minor millets. Major millets, they include pearl millet, sorghum and finger millet. Minor millets, they include foxtail millet, proso millet, kodo millet, barnyard millet and little millet. Pearl millet and sorghum are the important food grain crops in India after rice, wheat and maize in terms of area and production. And finger millet is also one of the major millet which is grown and is consumed in major parts in states like Karnataka, Telangana and Uttarakhand. And nowadays everyone is talking of millets. Whenever people talk of immunity and health, people first come out with millets. And if you just want to know what about what are these millets and how they are beneficial and why the millet production is beneficial. The millets are beneficial because they provide nutritious food, feed and fodder. They are less water consuming than other cereals. They grow faster, putting less stress on the environment. Less incidence of insects, pests and diseases. They can grow even on very poor and marginal lands. And they provide complete food and nutritional security. They will supplement the existing income of the farmers by reducing groundwater extraction. They combat desertification, increase farmer resilience to drought brought on by climate change. And United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization has declared year 2023 as International Year of Millets. And year 2018 was declared as National Year of Millets in India. And millets have been renamed as Nutri-Cereals by Government of India through a gazette notification issued on 13th April 2018. And these nutri-cereals include sorghum, bajra, finger millet and all these millets. And if you look into the health benefits of these nutri-cereals, they are beneficial in detoxifying the body, they lower the bad cholesterol level, they prevent the onset of breast cancer, they help to prevent type 2 diabetes, they are effective in reducing blood pressure, they help to protect against heart disease, aid in treating respiratory conditions such as asthma, they help to optimize kidney, liver and immune system, they reduce risk of gastrointestinal conditions like gastric ulcers and colon cancers, and they eliminate problems like constipation, excess gas, bloating and cramping. Now, if you look into the conditions and the statistics of millets, millet consumption in India is trending improvement for better health through functional foods. Now people have started knowing, understanding the importance of the nutritional value of these millets. The consumption pattern started including millets in their diets. And therefore, the consumption is increasing continuously in India. And if you look into the trends in the health and wellness industry, the tendency of people has changed. That is, they are moving from reactive to proactive. That is, from better to avoid treatment than going for treatment, it is better to go for prevention. So how they are going to prevent? By taking healthy diet. And how they are coming to get this healthy diet? By diversifying their diets. So going from just their traditional, the much more recently habituated condition of eating rice and wheat, people have started moving to taking up even millets, and they are trying to diversify their diets. And there is a big opportunity in the processed food sector. If you look into this, most of the processed food is only this much, semi-processed is this much, and this much is remaining for the unprocessed food. And almost all the processed food products are either coming from wheat, maize, or rice. And this much of unprocessed food segment is there, which can be explored by millets. And as I said, millets need very less water. If you look into the water requirement, sugarcane takes up almost 2,100 kgs of water to produce 1 kg of sugarcane. Rice takes 1,250 liters of water to produce 1 kg of rice. Whereas pearl millet or other millets, they take 350 to 400 kg of water or 1 kg of rice. You can see the extent of difference, how much of water is saved by growing these crops. And nowadays, grain drain is happening. Till now, we have been hearing about brain drain in India. Now, grain drain is happening because the cheapest cereals in India are the most expensive ones in US. Most of the people in US might be knowing about quinoa, millets. These are very premiumly priced products. I think for 1 pound, you people are shelling about $5 to $8. Whereas the same pearl millet, other things are available for a minimum of 20 rupees per kg. Compared with the $10, that is around 630 to 700 rupees per kg in US, whereas it is only 20 rupees per kg in India. And most of these millets are being now exported or taken by foreign countries, and they are taken up at a premium price in these markets. Now, when I started my talk, I said that climate change is also one of the biggest global threats. I said micronutrient malnutrition and climate change. If you look into the different crops, this is the thing which is showing the temperature. Wheat can withstand a temperature of 30 degrees. Rice can withstand a temperature of 32, maize maximum up to 40. Pearl millet is one which can withstand higher temperatures. It can even flower and set seed at as high temperatures as 42 degrees centigrade. And if you see the conditions where these different crops grow, rice needs nearly 900 to 2500 millimeters annual rainfall. Maize 500 to 800 mm annual rainfall, wheat 450 to 659, whereas pearl millet can grow even from areas receiving 200 millimeters to 600 millimeters rainfall. And this is a nutrient-rich crop, nutri-cereal. Coming to India and pearl millet, it is grown in an area of 6.93 million hectares, with a production of 8.61 million tons and a productivity of 1,243 kgs per hectare. The major pearl millet growing states are Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Gujarat, UP, MP, Haryana, Karnataka, all these states. Like in any other crop, pearl millet is also having different agroclimatic conditions suitable in different zones, as I mentioned. we have three different agroclimatic conditions zones for pearl millet. One is A1, other is A and B. Majority of the area is in A1 zone, which is represented by western part of the country, comprising those areas which receive less than 400 mm annual rainfall, covering western Rajasthan, Gujarat, and parts, very little part of Hisar. And there is another area called as another agroclimatic zone called as A, which comprises those states and areas receiving more than 400 mm, 2000 mm annual rainfall. And here the crop grows in a very good condition. And another agroclimatic zone represented here is the southern part of the country, which is B zone. And here the area is about 1.14 million hectares. And the climatic conditions and the requirements of the varieties and hybrids for these different zones are different. If you look into the area of production and productivity, this is a line which shows a constant continuous decline in area. And this is the line which is showing the productivity. In spite of the constant decline in area, you can see a constant and continuous increase in the productivity of the crop. So even though the area has reduced, the production and productivity are still higher because there is a continuous increase in the productivity. And this was attained because of the high yielding hybrids which were developed in pearl millet. Just now I mentioned that we have three different zones, A1 zone, A zone and B zone. These are the different areas and different material cultivars suitable for these areas. There also we have one more segment, that is summer segment, where it is nearly 0.4 million hectares. This is grown in Gujarat and those areas immediately after the harvest of potato. The soil will be rich in nutrients and it is grown up in summer months because the temperature is high, nutrients are available in the soil, and it is grown in those areas where they have irrigation facilities. So the crops, the pearl millet crop comes in a beautiful way, very good high yields. In normal condition, we get about 3.5 to 4 tons per hectare. Whereas in this summer pearl millet, the yields are as high as about 6 to 6.5 million tons per hectare. That is the extent of yield we get in summer pearl millet. Just now I mentioned that pearl millet is also mentioned as a nutri-cereal. It is rich in energy, carbohydrate, protein, fat and all these things. It is a gluten-free grain with low prolamin fraction, and it is ideal for people with gluten allergy. And Government of India has made efforts to include pearl millet and other millets in the public distribution system. And year 2018 is named as Year of Millets. This is the nutritional composition of pearl millet along with other millets compared to rice and wheat. Without any doubt, we can say that it is nutritionally superior to other grains we have. These are the different major nutrients, carbohydrates, proteins and fats. Proteins are gluten-free, low in lysine. Because they are gluten-free, they are suitable for people with allergy, celiac disease. And this is the only food grain which retains its alkaline property even after it enters our gut, enters the stomach, our digestive system. Remaining all other foods turn acidic. So if someone is having any problem, acidity or other gas problems, this is the best food which can be given to those people. It has low glycemic index. It is only 55. It is ideal for people suffering with diabetes. And it is having highest amount of fat. But if you see the composition of this fat, it has omega-6, that is linoleic acid, omega-9 and omega-3 fatty acids, highest content of these. People run after pufa. This is a rich source of cholesterol. It has a beautiful combination of different vitamins. See, in comparison with wheat, rice, or almond meals, it has a good, beautiful composition of vitamins. And just to, because we're talking of biofortification, iron and zinc, I just wanted to show the audience that this is the endosperm or the germ, and this is the endosperm. Iron is present in this layer, healthy round layer. Here, this is the iron and zinc is present here. Now, with this introduction of pearl millet, before coming to pearl millet, I spoke about different crops, the use of biofortification, why we should go for biofortification and all these things. Now, coming to pearl millet and biofortification, why this topic of point of biofortification has come to pearl millet? If you look into the intake of pearl millet in growing regions where pearl millet is grown, 35% of the total intake, the calories, protein, iron, and zinc is coming from pearl millet. These are the main pearl millet growing states, and it has been studies have been made in these areas, and it has been seen that nearly 35% of the total intake is coming from pearl millet. Now, as I mentioned earlier, biofortification aims to address nutrient deficiencies as an integral part of the poor breeding program. But there is a need to understand the potential impact of higher micronutrients on other important things. Now, enhanced nutrient content in new cultivars have to be achieved without any trade-off with higher productivity. That's what I said. Whenever we go for breeding with for biofortification, the farmer should also be happy and consumer also should be happy. For instance, selection for increased micronutrient content may be expected to negatively affect yield or other important agronomic traits. But this will happen only if the genes that increase micronutrient content are linked with genes having a deleterious effect on the yield. So the breeder, when he or she thinks of breeding a variety with high iron or zinc, they should see that there are no negative linkages of these nutrient contents with yield. So this is what I have shown in the beginning. The same slide again I'm showing here. So as shown here, first we have to see the genetic diversity for the micronutrient content. In pearl millet, they have seen a large amount of variation existing in different kinds of material. So this is the extent of information. Still some more references have been added, but I'm just trying to show here. This is the range for iron, starting from 29.4 ppm to 87.9. In some cases, it is 102. As well as 18 to as high as 139 ppm. Similarly, for zinc also, you can see as low as 13.5 to as high as 89.89. The large amount of variability is present in different kinds of material available in pearl millet. And it was also observed that the kind of association of iron with the different parameters, with zinc, it was shown to be significant and positive. It has been shown to have a slight negative or non-significant association with yield, then zinc with iron, zinc with grain yield, and many other parameters have been shown. And it is also shown in different studies that there is a direct positive correlation between iron and zinc. Higher the iron content, higher the zinc content also was observed in some studies. So with this background information, people started thinking of breeding for higher micronutrient content for iron and zinc in pearl millet. Now, as a breeder, when I think of breeding for iron and zinc content, okay, I'll make process, but how do I know how much iron or zinc is there in the material which I am breeding for? That means I need to go for phenotyping of that breed. For this, we have, that means it has to be screened. So a large amount of germplasm was screened, and for this XRF tool was available, which is time-saving and effective way of measuring the iron and zinc content. This is a extra. It uses non-destructive sampling. The cost is about only $2 per sample. It is restricted for only for iron and zinc for the time being. And the amount of data which is obtained for through XRF data, when compared with ICP, there is a correlation to an extent of 0.69 to 0.97, and for zinc it is 0.60 to 0.98. This is safe and simple to operate. It handles more number of samples per day, and it is relatively cheaper compared to the existing. Now, I said that at the international level, Harvest Plus has taken a lead in developing micronutrient-rich crops or biofortified crops. Same Harvest Plus has also taken a lead in pearl millet in developing iron-rich or zinc-rich varieties in pearl millet in the initial stages. And the first wave of efforts by Harvest Plus led to the development of the open pollinated variety called Dhanshiri, which was released in India in 2012. And then a second wave of release came from Harvest Plus in terms of a hybrid, which was released in 2014, that is MH-101. And another hybrid was also released, which was released in 2016. This is from the part of Harvest Plus. And this is the variety, the first variety, Dhanshakti, which was released by collaborative efforts of ICRISAT with the MPKV Dhule. And this was tested under ICL-ASRP and pearl millet, and also released, it was released through ASRP and pearl millet at the national level. Now, coming to the efforts of ICR, I said that there is a separate consortia research platform on biofortification led by ICR, in which pearl millet is also one of the crops, targeted crops. And in pearl millet, these are the two objectives: to develop pearl millet